The exception to the rule was the Bee Gees. In London, they linked up with manager Robert Stigwood, an Australian who'd moved to England years before and had worked with Beatles manager Brian Epstein. He had the contacts and the business acumen, and the Bee Gees had the song.
Always keep coming back. Maybe that's what it is.
Why is that? Is it some sort of renewal?
Yeah, I think so. We love Australia. It's partly our home, and England's partly our home.
John grew up in public on Australian television. In 1965, she won first prize in a talent contest organised by Johnny O'Keefe and a ticket to England.
I started in Australia, got my grounding there. I got my basic training, so to speak. I couldn't have done it without that. You know, I did television 5 days a week and I did lots of clubs, and it was a great training.
In England, she worked the clubs and television with her close friend Pat Carroll. She also did backing vocals for Cliff Richard. In 1970, she went solo and made the world charts in her own right.
How far can you go on doing this?
I hope as far as possible. Question. I just want to get better, really. I'm not madly ambitious that I want to be a huge star or anything like that. I just would like to get better at what I'm doing. You know, I just enjoy the work. I love doing it, and I travel a lot, and I meet great people. I have a ball. Maybe I hang around here a little more than I
should. You both know I got somewhere. By 1974, America in particular had adopted Olivia as their favourite girl next door. But her Australian connections held strong. Pat Carroll's husband, Australian John Farrar, produced and wrote many of her records. And I Honestly Love You, co-written by Australian Peter Allen, won her 2 Grammy Awards. Olivia's breakthrough was closely followed by Helen Reddy. Her song, I Am Woman, hit number one and became a theme for the women's liberation movement.
I can do anything. I am strong. I am invincible.
Invincible.
I am woman.
As Robbie G, guitarist, singer, Robbie Porter topped the Australian charts in the early 60s. As an actor, he starred in Hollywood films and on American TV. As a record producer, he instigated the international breakthroughs of Rick Springfield and Air Supply. And in the early 70s, he produced the band that provided one of the most significant breakthroughs for Australian music.
Good night, world. Don't pick on any teenagers.
By 1970, Slim Dusty was the only Australian to have topped the international charts without moving out of Australia. But Daddy Cool didn't think 12,000 kilometres was too far to fly to work. They debuted in America in 1971, and their Australian fame had preceded them. As it turned out, too much so.
Daddy Cool played at the Whiskey in about 1972, if I remember. I was there that first show. And it was incredible experience because the hype that had preceded it was like this was the next Beatles coming to American shores.
Now listen, oh, we're stepping out. I'm gonna turn around. Gonna turn around once I'm gonna do the Eagle Run.
Wasn't the best start, but Daddy Cool did end up with an American record contract, and they did mount three American tours. Their international following included Elton John and Rod Stewart.
They became the first band to live in Australia and to stay in Australia that toured the United States. So I think they opened the way for a lot of other Australian bands, and they should be given some kind of award for that.
Sherbet hit number two in England with How's That in 1976. They'd been trying for world release since 1974, and they became the first Australian group to put an Australian-made record on top of the international charts.
I first came over here into America in 1974, and I was shopping a record deal for Sherbet, and it was sort of strange, first time being out of the country, but you automatically got on the defense, because when you'd say you had a band from Australia and you were looking for a deal, the Americans sort of sarcastically, but in a nice way, would say, oh, you mean they make records down there?
Little River Band's first airplay in America was in Jacksonville, Florida, where local announcer Bill Bartlett had played an imported copy of their first Australian album. It proved a popular choice.
In the East Coast were all supports to bands like the Average White Band, and we got down to Jacksonville and we were huge stars. We did 10,000 people in Jacksonville in our first concert, and we were flabbergasted, and that really gave us a taste of what we could do in America.
They played in concert in Jacksonville, Florida, sold out two dates, headlining, and the rest is history. Capitol put their machine together. The group became one of Capitol's biggest groups ever.
When this car was made, 1965 Mustang, I was well on the way. I was in the twilights and making my first album.
Little River Band's founding members had certainly paid their dues both at home and in bands that had been unsuccessful in England.
You're the only one I want to be with. To get through to you.
Just a... In 1974, they returned to Australia with a new band in mind.
Glenn and I were in the back seat of a car. I remember it was one of our very, very first engagements in a place called Geelong. And as you drive down to Geelong, you pass a little place called Little River on the way. Glenn saw the sign and said, oh, that'd be a good song title. And like, immediately following that, he said, Little River Band.
Hurry, don't be late. I can hardly wait. I said to myself when we're
by 1980, they'd sold well over 3 million albums. Not only making them the most successful Australian band ever, they had become one of the most successful bands in the world.
Well, frankly, I thought LRB's main appeal would be the fact that they sounded a little bit like the bands that were happening at that time, the Eagles, Jackson, Brown thing, but with a significant difference. The fact of of the harmonies with Beeb's voice being so strident was a more English Hollies type sound, and I thought maybe that particular peculiar combination would be interesting at American radio. Take it easy on me. It should be easy to see. I'm getting lost in the crowd.
One thing for sure, after LRB's breakthrough, the world knew Australia was a music-producing nation. Take it easy on me.
Point should be made that it had to take follow-up. We always said right from the outset, even though we were getting successful, we said to everybody that interviewed us and that we talked to, was that in Australia there's a wonderful depth of talent there.
The Saints were a Brisbane band. Their independent single Stranded topped the London alternative charts in 1976. The group were hailed as pioneers of the punk rock movement.
Like a snake calling on a phone. I've got no time to be alone. Summer coming at me all the time. You better think I'll lose my mind. Cause I'm stranded on my own. Stranded far from home. Alright.
The Bee Gees, remembering their own training, encouraged young brother Andy to live in Australia to develop his own style. He arrived in America in 1977 and proved he'd learned well with a series of number ones. The same year, Australian vocalist Samantha Sang made it to the top of the world charts with a song written for her by Barry Gibb. Meanwhile, back in Sydney, Australia, John Paul Young was recording songs written and produced by ex-Easy Beats George Young and Harry Vander. The results made hit parades around the world in 1977 and 78. George and Harry continued recording in their spare time as Flash in the Pan. They made the international charts with Hey St. Peter in 1977, and a year later with The Band Played On, and again in 1983 with Waiting for a Train.